we mean by acquired heart diseases, there are a group of diseases like cardiomyopathies, cardiovascular infections, like myocarditis, infected endocarditis, or acute rheumatic fever, and non-congenital valvular heart diseases. These are the commonest group of acquired heart diseases, which means that these diseases are not present at birth. That is to say, the baby delivers with normal heart, but during infancy, childhood, or adolescence, he develops one of these diseases. While at birth, the heart was normal. That واضح? Okay. As common and important example of the acquired heart diseases, we got rheumatic fever. Of course, you have read and heard about rheumatic fever, but we are going to take it from the pediatric point of view. Rheumatic fever is an autoimmune reaction in certain genetically predisposed children to group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infections of the pharynx, tonsils, or the area around the tonsils, the pharynx, when infected by group A beta hemolytic streptococci. Some of the children who have certain genetic predisposition may develop autoimmune reaction. And this autoimmune reaction affects the joints, the heart, skin, and the brain. Epidemiologically speaking, rheumatic fever is a disease of children aging 5 to 14 years old, with very variable incidence from 3 to 61 per 100,000 school children, depending on the different populations, hygienic conditions, and socioeconomic class. And generally, it doesn't affect children less than 5 years. If you look here, the incidence is very low, below the age of 3 years. And then after the age of 4 years, 5 years, it starts to increase dramatically until the age of 15 years, and then it declines again. Because these age groups, from 5 to 15, are those who are the most commonly predisposed to group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infections of the throat. And rheumatic fever is closely linked to this disorder. Commonly it is seen in winter and spring months, a seasonal variation that is similar to that of streptococcal pharyngitis. Clinically speaking, the clinical manifestations and the diagnosis of rheumatic fever is summarized in Jones criteria, which includes major criteria and minor criteria. And in fact, the presence of two major criteria of Jones, or one major criteria of Jones plus two minor criteria, along with an incidence evidence of antecedent streptococcal infection, is required for the diagnosis of rheumatic fever. So the presence of two major criteria, any two of the major criteria, or one major plus two minor criteria, plus evidence of streptococcal infection of the throat, confirm the diagnosis of rheumatic fever. Usually, a throat infection precedes rheumatic fever by 2 to 6 weeks. The patient keeps history of pharyngitis 2 to 6 weeks before the onset of rheumatic fever, onset of symptoms and signs of rheumatic fever. So what are the Jones criteria? As I said, rheumatic fever is an autoimmune reaction that involves the heart, the skin, the joints, and the brain. In fact, the major criteria are polyarthritis, carditis, erythema marginatum, subcutaneous nodules, and Sydenham scoria. So there are five in number: polyarthritis, carditis, Sydenham scoria, erythema marginatum, and subcutaneous nodule. The commonest manifestations are those of polyarthritis. It usually affects knees, wrists, and ankles, and characterized by all features of arthritis, that is to say, pain, redness, hotness, tenderness, and limitation of activity. And it is afflicting of or migratory arthritis. What is the meaning of migratory? It means that one joint is affected for a time lasting less than 1 week. When the first joint resolves in its inflammation, a second joint will be started to be affected. So the inflammation migrates or flicks from one joint to another for a time, about 1 week. This joint continues to be inflamed and then resolves. And after resolution of its inflammation, the arthritis will shift to another joint. And this will continue for 1 to 2 months if left untreated. And this type of arthritis is called migratory arthritis or flitting arthritis. This is seen in about 80% of the patients with rheumatic fever. Second major criteria is pancarditis. What I mean by pancarditis, it means it involves the endocardium, the myocardium, and the pericardium. All layers of the heart are likely to be involved. For example, the involvement of the endocardium is mainly manifested as valvular dysfunction because the valves tissues are those of the endocardium. So endocarditis is manifested as valvular dysfunction and murmur, while myocarditis, which is the second layer of the heart, can be manifested as cardiomegaly, heart failure, shock, and even death. Pericarditis can be manifested as pericardial rupt, effusion, or even pericardial tamponade. These are the most common manifestations of carditis, of rheumatic fever. These are the most common two major criteria of rheumatic fever: polyarthritis and carditis. Less commonly, we got Sydenham scoria, erythema marginatum, and subcutaneous nodules, which are very rare. Sydenham scoria, which is due to the involvement with the basal ganglia of the brain, is a late manifestation, doesn't occur in the early in the course of the illness. It may take 2 to 6 months until it becomes manifested and characterized by involuntary or dancing movement with emotional liability. It may continue for 3 to 6 months if left untreated. Erythema marginatum, it is seen during the acute phase with carditis and arthritis. And it is characterized by pinkish macular rash, pink macules that spread on the trunk and on the extremities, and characterized by dark margin and pale center. They increase in size and then coalesce, that is to say, unite with each other to form map-like outline. The appearance will be map-like. It's seen less than 5% of the patients. Lastly, we got the subcutaneous nodules, and this is very rare. It's also similar to Sydenham's chorea. It is a late manifestation of the disease. It's characterized by small, painless, pea-sized, and hard nodules, mainly seen on the extensor surfaces of the extremities, like on the fingers and the extensor surface of the joints, the interphalangeal joints, and the limbs on the extensor surface. So the patient, if got any two of these manifestations, this is enough to diagnose rheumatic fever if he got evidence of the streptococcal infection, as we are going to explain it. But if he got only one of these major criteria, like only carditis, let's to say, or only arthritis, at that time, we need two minor criteria to support the diagnosis. So what are the minor criteria? They include fever, polyarthralgia. Arthralgia is different from arthritis. Arthritis means inflammation. Arthralgia means painful joints. Not inflammation, just painful joints. Or history of past rheumatic fever. Other minor manifestations by lab may be increased or raised acute phase reactants like IESR, high C-reactive protein, or leukocytosis. Or on ECG, there might be prolongation of the PR interval. So any one of these is considered as minor criteria. If you got only one major criteria, then you need two of these ones, like IESR, like or IESR plus prolongation of the PR interval. These are two minor criteria. Or for example, fever plus prolongation of the PR interval. These are two minor criteria. Keep in your mind, polyarthralgia should not be taken as minor criteria if there is polyarthritis. Since polyarthritis is a major criteria and arthritis is characterized by pain, so it is not suitable to take arthralgia as a minor criteria if we take polyarthritis as major criteria. By this, we collected the major and minor criteria to diagnose rheumatic fever, and just we need evidence of past streptococcal infection of the throat. And this could be in the form of elevated ASO titer called anti-C-triptoglycine or streptococcal antibodies, rather than streptococcal antibodies. Another evidence of streptococcal infection of the throat is positive throat culture or rapid antigen test for group A streptococcal. So here, antibody, elevated antibody titer, or here, detection of antigen of streptococcal. Or if there is recent history of scarlet fever, I think you have studied scarlet fever. If you don't study it, you will study it later with Dr. Asif with the infectious diseases, and he will explain to you scarlet fever. So if the patient has any one of these, this is considered as an evidence of past streptococcal infection of the throat. You cannot diagnose rheumatic fever in the presence of major and minor criteria unless you got evidence of streptococcal infection of the throat by any one of these: raised antibody titer, gene anti the gene the detection positive throat culture or scarlet fever history. Patients with rheumatic fever, by investigations, may show the following. Some of them are part of the criteria, diagnostic criteria. High ESR, anemia leukocytosis, elevated C-reactive protein, high ASO titer, anti-streptolysin O titer, more than 210 units. Anti-DNA's B test, which is antibody, it's antigen detection test. Throat group I beta hemolytic streptococcal infection, positive culture. By ECG, you may see prolongation of the PR interval. This is the P wave, and this is the beginning of the R wave, more than 0.2 seconds. You see in two large squares. One large square. And maybe second degree or even third degree heart blocks, ST segment depression or T inversion, all could be seen on ECG. So prolongation of the PR interval, which is first degree heart block, could be seen. The same, second or third degree heart block could be seen also. ST segment and T wave inversions can be seen. By echocardiography, you can see the bladder dysfunction, valvular edema, myocardial dilatation at the level of artery and ventricles, impaired contractility, and pericardial effusion. All these can be seen by echocardiography. Mm-hmm. This is a summary of what we have seen by Johns Cafe Paul, and this summarizes the diagnostic criteria. You can review it. Management. Once you diagnose rheumatic fever, you have to eradicate the underlying streptococcal infection of the throat by giving the patient benzathine penicillin, 0.6 to 1.2 mega units or million units intramuscularly. And also, this serves as the first dose of penicillin prophylaxis that we are giving to explain. If the patient is allergic to penicillin, you can give it oral erythromycin and a dose of 40 milligrams per kg per day in 2 to 4 divided doses for 10 days. Bed rest. Once you diagnose rheumatic fever, after giving the antibiotic, you have to advise for bed rest. And this depends on the severity of the condition and may range from week to several weeks. And after that, the patient may have a period of indoor ambulation, movement within the house, and then he can be allowed to go to school. Mm-hmm. Once you diagnose rheumatic fever after giving penicillin or erythromycin and restricting the movement of the patient, you may need to give anti-inflammatory therapy. We have two anti-inflammatory agents, non-steroidal, which is aspirin, or steroidal, which is a prednisone. Usually, prednisolone is preserved for the severe carditis cases. So you may go rheumatic fever with arthritis alone, or rheumatic fever with mild carditis, or arthritis with moderate carditis, or rheumatic fever with severe carditis. Severe carditis means heart failure, means that the patient got heart failure. Only if there is such condition, that is to say rheumatic fever with heart failure, then prednisolone can be given for a duration of 2 to 6 weeks. Otherwise, if there is moderate mild carditis or no carditis, just arthritis, here, aspirin is enough. For arthritis alone, it is given for 1 to 2 weeks. For mild carditis, 3 to 4 weeks. And for moderate CAR, that is for 6 to 8 weeks. So this is the situation for using anti-inflammatory agents. Again, prednisone or prednisolone is reserved for the severe carditis, which is characterized by heart failure. Otherwise, there is no need for mild, moderate, or no arthritis, only aspirin, and for variable duration depending on the severity of the condition. And these are the doses of these agents when given orally. Treatment of heart failure, if it is associated with rheumatic fever, and I'm going to explain it next lecture. Management of sudden harm score here, if it's present later on, as I said, may happen 2 to 6 months later, by decreasing the physical and emotional stress to the patient, and giving some drugs like phenobarbital, haloperidol, valproic acid, chlorpromazine, diazepam, or even steroids. After managing the acute phase of rheumatic fever, you have to prevent its recurrence. By preventing the throat infection, we said in the beginning, the problem is group A beta hemolytic streptococcal infection of the throat, just followed by an autoimmune reaction that affects the brain, the skin, the joints, and the heart. So if you prevent the recurrence of the throat infection, you can prevent this autoimmune reaction. Prevention of the throat infection is the continuous administration of antibiotics. And these antibiotics can be given either in the form of benzathine penicillin G in a dose of 1.2 megauniters intramuscularly every 4 weeks, or by giving oral penicillin V, 200 milligrams, twice daily. And if the patient is allergic to penicillin, he can be given sulfadiazine. And if he is allergic to both of them, can be given erythromycin. And these are the doses of these agents. So, benzathine penicillin, oral penicillin V, sulfadiazine, or erythromycin. All these can be used as prophylaxis to prevent recurrence of streptococcal infection of the throat and to prevent the autoimmune reaction. For how long to give these prophylactic antibiotics? It depends on what happens with the heart, because the heart is the main organ that's involved. If there is rheumatic fever without carditis, there is no involvement of the heart. You give these antibiotics prophylaxis for 5 years or until the age of 21 years, whichever is longer. For example, if the patient is 13 years old, you have to give these antibiotics until the age of 21 years, because this is longer than 5 years. But if he is 18 years, you have to give it for 5 years, because 5 years is longer than 3 years, which is needed until reaching the age of 21 years. So give the antibiotics for 5 years or until the age of 21, whichever is longer. And this is applied for rheumatic fever without carditis. Now, fever with carditis, but without residual heart disease, that is to say no viable heart disease. For example, myocarditis or pericarditis happens, or even endocarditis, but the heart condition improves and returns to normal situation, and there is no residual valve heart disease. In this case, we give it for 10 years or until the age of 21, whichever is longer. As I explained here, use 10 years prophylaxis or until the patient becomes 21 years. Whichever is longer, which duration is longer, you have to use it. And the last category, rheumatic fever with carditis and residual valvular heart disease. And here, you have to give it at least 10 years or until the patient is 40 years age, whichever is longer. Sometimes even they use lifelong prophylaxis. finished rheumatic fever. Now, the next topic of acquired heart disease is we got the cardiomyopathies. You will face them frequently in your medical life in the future. And from their naming, cardiomyopathies means pathologies affecting the myocardium. That is to say, diseases of the myocardium itself. And they are affecting the cardiac muscle and not associated with any congenital, valvular, or coronary heart diseases or systemic disorders. They are primary myocardial diseases and classified into three major groups: hypertrophic, dilated or congestive, and restrictive cardiomyopathies. So, myopathies are diseases of the myocardium and the primarily affecting the myocardium without being secondary to valvular, congenital, or coronary heart disease, or even part of systemic disorder, and classified into hypertrophic, dilated, or restrictive. Let's see what's the difference between these three groups. We are going to make it as a table so that it becomes easy and simple for you. And we are going to make comparison between the different types according to etiology, hemodynamic dysfunction, neglect and manifestations, investigations, and management. So from etiology point of view, let us to show you this picture first. This is the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in systole and diastole. You see the myocardium severely hypertrophied. So the myocardium severely hypertrophied in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. While in dilated or congested cardiomyopathy, the myocardium is severely dilated. Here, hypertrophied, severely hypertrophied, while here, is severely dilated in congestive or dilated type, but in restrictive type, it is a little bit hypertrophied and stiff, very stiff. This is the difference from the anatomical point of view. So going back to the etiology, in hypertrophic type may be inherited as autosomal dominant in 50% of the cases. Some of the cases are sporadic. The dilated one is a pluricausal, multiple causes. Maybe due to toxins affecting the myocardium, metabolic disorders, infectious, alcohol, doxorubicin, etc. All this can affect the myocardium primarily, resulting in dilated cardiomyopathy. While the restrictive side, it may be due to myocardial fibrosis or due to infiltration by amyloid or by hemochromatosis. Regarding the hemodynamic dysfunction, you know the heart has two functions: relaxation, which is the diastole, to receive blood, and contraction, which is systole, reject the blood. So we have systolic and diastolic functions. Both of them are normal. The diastolic function should be normal so that the heart can relax normally and receive adequate amount of blood, and to contract adequately, reject enough amount of blood to the circulation. So the systolic function also should be normal. Any one of them, if is defective, so the patient will have complaints. In hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, mainly there is diastolic dysfunction. Because the cardiac muscle is hypertrophied and thick, it doesn't relax normally, so the heart cannot receive adequate amount of blood like normal heart. In dilated cardiomyopathy, mainly there is systolic function, so the heart cannot contract normally. And in restrictive cardiomyopathy, again, there is diastolic dysfunction, similar to the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but much more. The diastolic dysfunction with restrictive cardiomyopathy is much more than that which is present in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So there is a stiff myocardium in hypertrophic and restrictive cardiomyopathy, while dilated cardiomyopathy, there is a floppy and dilated myocardia. Regarding the symptoms, in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the infants frequently have signs of heart failure. Older children may have variable symptoms. Sometimes it is symptomless and presented as sudden death. You may hear about, or you may have seen, some athletes who are practicing some sports, like football or American football, they die in the stadium without any preceding symptoms. Some of these patients have hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Some patients may have dyspnea, fatigability, chest pain, or even syncopal attacks. Some may have palpitations due to arrhythmias. So in older children, the presentation is variable. Any one of these I mentioned is possible. In infants, if it is present in the infancy, they are presented with signs of heart failure that I'm going to explain next lecture. In older children, sudden death, dyspnea, fatigability, chest pain, syncope, near syncope palpitations. Patients with dilated cardiomyopathy, they have signs and symptoms of heart failure. Patients with restrictive cardiomyopathy, they have exercise intolerance, weakness, dyspnea, or even chest pain. So exercise intolerance, weakness, dyspnea, or chest pain may be seen in restrictive cardiomyopathy. On examination, in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, you may hear a murmur in 50% of the cases. And in fact, this murmur is due to the obstruction of left ventricle of the fluid pump. Let's go back to this picture. This is a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. You see the interventricular septum severely hypertrophied, causing narrowing of the LVOT. And this may produce turbulence of blood flow and murmur. So in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, you may hear a murmur. While in children with congestive heart failure or dilated cardiomyopathy, you find signs and symptoms of congestive heart failure that I'm going to explain later. In children with restrictive cardiomyopathy, you will find murmurs of valvular dysfunction, because these children usually have mitral and tricuspid valve regurgitations. So you will hear the murmurs of these disorders. Again, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, a murmur can be heard due to LVOT obstruction. And dilated cardiomyopathy, signs and symptoms of heart failure. And in restrictive cardiomyopathy, murmurs of valvular dysfunction can be heard. By echocardiography, in hypertrophic one, that is myocardial hypertrophy. In dilated one, dilatation of both ventricles and decrease in the ejection fraction. In restrictive cardiomyopathy, there is biarterial enlargement and dilatation because of the stiff ventricles which cannot receive the blood. So accumulating blood in the artery causes biarterial dilatation. By ECG, in hypertrophic one, there might be LVH, ST segment, T wave changes with deep Q wave. And dilated one, again, LVH, ST segment, T wave changes, the same as hypertrophic one, with sinus tachycardia. In restrictive one, frequently, there is atrial hypertrophy can be seen in ECG called P mitral. You may see different types of arrhythmias like atrial fibrillation and supraventricular tachycardia. And all of them, by chest X-ray, you may see pulmonary congestion and you may see cardiomegaly and even a pleural effusion and pulmonary edema. treatment, an hypertrophic one, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, treated by beta blockers and calcium channel blockers. Now, some cases you may need surgery, but digoxin, catechols, diuretics, or nitrates are contraindicated because all of these improve the myocardial contractility or decrease the circulating volume, which have negative effect on the patient. So they are, should be avoided. You can use beta adrenal receptor blockers or calcium channel blockers alone. And dilated one, it is the treatment of congestive heart failure that I'm going to explain next lecture. Plus minus antiarrhythmic agents and plus minus cardiac transplantation if there is advanced case which has not responded to medical treatments. In restrictive type, similar to dilated type, you can use diuretics, anticoagulants plus minus, corticosteroids plus minus can be used also. Pacemakers may be used in patients with advanced heart block, and also cardiac transplantation when the patient has advanced disease and not responding to a medical treatment. By this, we finish the lecture of acquired heart diseases. And you have two options. Now it is 9:07 time. We can either continue the next lecture, or you have a break until 9:30, and then you continue the next lecture.
So,
if anyone again this opinion not to continue, please you can raise your hand. So will not continue. Of the majority of the students, they reject to continue. Anyone اللي ما يريد نستمر بالمحاضرة التالية يرفع إيده حتى نعرف إيش قد عدد الطلاب اللي ما يريدون حتى ما نكمل. أوكي، عدد الطلاب الحاضرين حاليا 23. اللي raised hand حاليا واحد فقط، واحد فقط رفع ايده لانه ما يريد يكمل، فناخذ بالاغلبيه اللي هم 22 واللي يريدون يكمل، وراح نكمل بناء على فقط الاغلبيه الساحقه. اوكي، let's go there. الصورة واضحة يا شباب؟
نعم دكتور واضح.
صوت واضح ماكو إشكال؟
لا دكتور ماكو إشكال.
Okay. The last lecture in the series of pediatric cardiology is the lecture of congestive heart failure. And these are the objectives of this lecture. You know, heart failure is the final problem or the final outcome of almost all cardiac diseases, either congenital or acquired. By definition, it is inability of the heart to pump enough amount of blood to the body tissues to give their needs of oxygen and the nutrients, and also inability of the heart to get rid of the pulmonary venous return. So the pulmonary venous return accumulates. The venous return in general, whether pulmonary or systemic. So the heart cannot pump enough amount of blood to the tissues and cannot get rid of the venous return to the heart. So, logically, the venous return, whether pulmonary or systemic, accumulates inside the heart. At the same time, the heart cannot eject enough amount of blood to the tissues. And consequently, the tissues cannot receive adequate amount of oxygen and the nutrients. Causes of heart failure in pediatrics are many, The most common one are the congenital groups, and you remember, especially the left-right shunts can cause congestive heart failure, VSD, PDA, ASD, atrial ventricular septal defects, etc. Less commonly, the myocardial diseases, just we explained before, like congestive heart failure, arrhythmias, and more and more causes which are rare include metabolic disorders, endocrine disorders, anemia, drugs such as anthracycline, etc. Here there's an important thing to remember, what we call the Frank Starling law or Frank Starling experiment. Two scientists called Frank and Starling stated that, by experiment of course, they stated that a normal heart, as long as you increase the venous return to the heart and increase the end diastolic volume of the heart and the end diastolic pressure of the heart, especially of the LV, the cardiac output increases. So as long as the end diastolic volume and the pressure increases, the cardiac output increases a normal heart until it reaches a certain value, and then it drops. Can no more augment its cardiac output, I mean the heart. In failing heart, they found that the failing heart also can augment its cardiac output in response to the end diastolic volume increase, but to much, much more less extent. So the failing heart cannot augment its output in response to an increase in the end diastolic volume. If we give drugs to the failing heart, it improves the situation and it can augment the systolic volume more than the failing heart without the drugs, but still it is less than the normal heart. So this is the basis of Frank Starling law. So what we got here is an increasing end diastolic volume and increasing cardiac index. And this makes the principles of the pathophysiology and management of heart failure. If the patient develops heart failure, we start to have some sort of compensatory mechanisms that the body adapts to overcome this heart failure. So, first we have an increase in the sympathetic tone. Tone, it means secretion of the catecholamines with their effect. So, decrease in the cardiac output results in increased adrenergic activity under stimulation and control of the brain. An increased adrenergic activity, let's say epinephrine, norepinephrine, results in activation of the beta 1 adrenergic receptors in the heart. And this will result in an increase in the heart rate and contractility. And this will result in an increase in the cardiac output. This is a normal cycle, but on the expense of, if the heart rate is increased and the contractility is increased, there is a problem of an increase in the afterload because these adrenergic substances causes peripheral vasoconstriction. Also, an increased heart rate causes hypermetabolism, may cause arrhythmias and myocardial toxicity on long term. And of course, they can be inhibited by giving the patients beta blockers, which form the basis of some treatments that I'm going to tell you shortly after. So the first effect, which happens in response to decreased cardiac output, is a sympathetic tone and the cycle. That's why the patient with heart failure usually have tachycardia, galopism, and excessive sweating due to an increased adrenergic activity. Second, when the patient has heart failure and decreased renal blood flow, as part of all body organs, which has reduced the blood flow due to decreased ejection fraction of the heart, there will be stimulation of renin-angiotensin system by the kidneys and the formation of angiotensin 2. Why? Because angiotensin 2 will be converted to aldosterone. Aldosterone causes water and salt retention to increase the blood volume, to increase the blood which comes to the kidneys. But it increases the blood volume and increases the blood which is coming to the heart. It's called preload because the blood volume is increased. And this will causes increased cardiac workload. And this will augment the heart failure. So it has bad effect. Stimulation of renin angiotensin system causes bad effect. A compensatory mechanism, but has a bad effect on the heart. First, cause salt and water retention, increase the plasma volume, increase preload. So it can cause edema. At the same time, angiotensin 2 has peripheral vasoconstrictive effect and increases the afterload, means the resistance against which the heart is pumping the blood, but afterload. So also, this will decrease the cardiac output to the tissues. And also, this will result in augmentation of the heart failure. So, by summary, stimulation of renin angiotensin system, which happens in response to decreasing of blood flow, causes stimulation of the angiotensin formation, angiotensin 2, and this will result in peripheral vasoconstriction and aldosterone formation, which causes both of them causes a negative effect on the failing heart. Clinical manifestations of heart failure, pediatric. In infants, because they are not mobile, they have poor feeding activities, failure to drive, tachypnea, and excessive sweating, especially with feeding, because their main exercise is the feeding. All the children may be presented with easy fatigability and edema as symptoms. On examination, it depends which part of the heart is failing. If it is left-sided heart failure, there is tachypnea, orthopnea, wheezing, and pulmonary edema. These crackles of the chest. If it is right-sided heart failure, there might be hepatomegaly, edema, ascites, and distended neck veins. So it depends which part of the heart is failing. If it is congested, that is, both of them are involved, right and left, both of features can be seen. Again, in infants, feeding difficulties and sweating with failure to thrive. All the children, fatigability, dyspnea, and edema as symptoms. Signs depend which side of the heart is failing. By investigations, cardiomegaly is the important cardinal feature can be seen in a child with heart failure, in addition to the pulmonary congestion and the pleural diffusion. You may see pulmonary edema, pleural diffusion, and cardiomegaly. How can we measure the cardiomegaly by chest x-ray? By what we call it CT ratio, cardiothoracic ratio. How it is measured? By taking well-centralized chest x-ray in the standing position, we draw a vertical line like this one, in the middle of the sternum. So first, you draw a vertical line. And then we measure the distance from this line to the apex, most prominent or most distal point in the apex on the left side, and from the right side, the most prominent point in the base of the heart. So let us say C1 and C2. So we measure C1 on the right side and C2 from the left side. And by summarizing both of them, by summating both of them, you got C, the cardiac diameter. So C is equal to C1 plus C2. By this, you got the cardiac diameter. You see, they are not at the same line. This is in one level, and this is in another level. Not the same level, not one continuous line. So you got C. And then we got the thoracic diameter. It's drawn by drawing a horizontal line on the inner border of ribs. So you have certain criteria of this line. Number one, it is horizontal, should be horizontal. Zero angulation. Second, should be from the inner border of the ribs, from both right and left side. And number three, should be touching the right dome of the diaphragm. So horizontal line from the inner border of the ribs, touching the right dome of the diaphragm, represents the thoracic diameter. Now you get C, which is the cardiac diameter, and you get T, which is the thoracic diameter. CT ratio is calculated by dividing C by T multiplied by 100. In infants, C over T should be less than 55%. And in older children, should be less than 50%. For example, C is found to be, let us to say, 6 centimeters. And T is found to be 10 centimeters. So C over T multiplied by 100 is 6 over 10 multiplied by 100. By this, it will be 60%, that is to say, cardiomegaly. Now this is the value of the X-ray. In addition, ECG can be done, but its value in diagnosing heart failure is of little importance. It may help them to determine the cause of the underlying heart failure by saying, by showing, for example, axis deviation, hypertrophies, etc. Echocardiography is the gold standard tool for the diagnosis of heart failure. And by AM-MODE measurements that I'm going to explain to you in the sixth class, inshallah, next year, we can measure the ejection fraction of the heart. This is the ejection fraction of the heart. And can be calculated as percentage of 100. For example, in this patient, it is 86%. Normally, it should be 55% and more. So the ejection fraction normally should be 55% or more, which means the ejection of the blood, the fraction of the blood which is ejected per contraction, or ejection fraction percent. Now, for example, the heart received 100 mil of the venous return. If it is normal, it should eject 55 mil at least of this venous return per contractile action. In this case, the ejection fraction is said to be 55%. If it is 70%, if 70% of the venous return is ejected by the heart, at that time, it is said that the ejection fraction is 70%, and so on. At least it should be 55%. And this is called AM-MODE of echo examination. As I told you, I'll explain it to you in the sixth class. Don't bother yourself now. Just know that the echo is a powerful tool for the diagnosis of heart failure by measuring the ejection fraction. And also, it is helpful in diagnosing the cause of heart failure, for example, congenital heart disease. Also, it is useful to know the response to treatment. After giving a treatment to the patient for a while, let's say, for example, a few days, you repeat the echo and you find that your patient got improved ejection fraction. So the response is okay. Coming to the treatment of patients with heart failure, this is a nice figure. In fact, I arranged it for you in order not to forget. So just remember 7D. First D, determine the underlying cause and correct it. Second D, diet. Decrease salt and increase caloric intake. Third D, diuretics. Fourth D, digoxin. Fifth D, dilators like angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor. 7D is dopamine. Sixth D, dopamine. And seventh D, donation of heart to the patient all of these are useless. These are the 7 days that should be remembered, and it summarizes the treatment of your patient. If you forget the treatment, just remember these lines, the 7 days. Any cause, first, treatment of the underlying cause or contributing factor. Any cause that is correctable and contributing to heart failure should be treated. For example, if there is congenital heart disease, it should be corrected by surgery if it causes heart failure. Hypertension, arrhythmias, anemias, fever, all of these should be corrected and treated if they are contributing or causing heart failure. Also, we got, in addition to the underlying cause, we got general measures, including bed rest to the patient. Usually, the head, the head is upright, and the position is semi-upright position. Decrease the pulmonary edema by giving the patient oxygen. And adequate calories should be given to the patient so that he receives 150 to 160 kilocalories per kg per day. And decreasing the salt intake, especially the salty snacks like chips and pretzels. Pretzels are the أصابع المقرمشة الموجودة مثل مثل الأسبيكتي. ما أعرف يسمونه بالله أصابع على شكل مالحة مثل البسكت يعني. If there is a respiratory failure, you have to intubate the patient and put him on ventilator support. So these are the general measures, and you can read it. They are very easy. And third line is drug therapy. So we summarize the treatment by 7D. And these 7D can be divided into three groups or three lines of management. First line is the treatment and correction of underlying cause. A second line is the general measures, and the third line is the drug therapy. In fact, if we come here, there's what we call it preload, that is to say the blood which is returning to the heart, and afterload, that is to say the resistance against which the heart ejects the blood. And we got the heart. So we have preload, afterload, which is the resistance, and the myocardium. When we treat the heart failure, we have either to act on this, the preload, or on this, the afterload, or on the myocardium itself. Whatever the line of the management, we have to act on any one of these. So let's start with the commonly used group of drugs, which are called the diuretics. In fact, the diuretics act by decreasing the preload, decreasing the blood volume, and hence decreasing the preload, that is to say the amount of the blood which is returning to the heart. And when the preload is decreased, the cardiac and diastolic pressure and volume will be decreased. And according to the Frank Starling law, there will be improvement in the cardiac function. There are a lot of number of diuretics. The commonly used two in pediatrics are furosemide, which is prophylactics, or spironolactone, which is aldosterone antagonist, called aldactone. So prophylactics are aldactone, or the commonest two drugs. And they are used in these doses orally, 2-3 milligrams per kg per day in 2-3 divided doses. And spironolactone nearly the same, also 1-3 milligrams per kg per day in 2-3 divided doses. So these are the most important two. In fact, almost all diuretics causes a side effect, which is important, which is hypokalemia. Whether thiazide diuretics, loop diuretics, and also hyponatremia, except the potassium sparing diuretics, like spironolactone, which causes hyperkalemia. When you give diuretics, either you give, for example, loop diuretic like furosemide with potassium to prevent hypokalemia because it is serious and causes a lot of side effects, or we give two types of diuretics, Lasix plus spironolactone, so that the potassium will be balanced. Loop diuretics causes hypokalemia, and potassium sparing diuretics causes hyperkalemia, so the potassium will be will remain a normal level. Another group of drugs which act on the myocardium. Diuretics act on the preload. Now, digitalis glycosides act on the myocardium and affect the contractility of the myocardium. طلع بالصوت واضح ماكو اشكال؟
نعم دكتور واضح.
الصورة واضحة ماكو اشكال؟
لا دكتور ماكو اشكال.
جيد جدا. ديوكسين acts directly on the myocardium and improves its contractility. So now we are acting on the myocardium. We use diuretics to act on the preload. Now we act on the myocardium by using digoxin. The role of digoxin, in simple words, is increasing the myocardial contractility by affecting the sodium and calcium channels that are present in the myocardial cells. It has long half-life, so that can be given once daily, even if you like, or can be given also two times daily. But it has certain strategy of administration. So when a patient is presented to you initially with heart failure, you have to give it in the following protocol. First, we calculate a dose called total digitalizing dose. Total digitalizing dose. It is calculated like that. According to the age groups, there is a dose calculated in microgram per kg. Microgram per kg, not milligram per kg. Please be careful about that. Microgram per kg. Because if you give it in a term of milligram per kg, this is fatal. The patient will die. Let us to say we get a patient who is 1 year old and 10 kilograms in weight. So the total digitalizing dose in a term of microgram per kg is 40 to 50 microgram per kg. If he is 10 kilograms and we calculate it as 40, so 40 multiplied by 10, the total digitalizing dose will be 400 microgram. Again, a child less than 1 year who is 10 kilograms presented with heart failure for the first time. We calculate the total digitalizing dose by multiplying 40 by his weight, which is 10 kilograms. So 40 by 10 is 400 micrograms are the total digitalizing dose. This total digitalizing dose is divided into three parts. First part, which is half of the total, that is to say 200 micrograms, is given immediately. So half of the total digitalizing dose is given immediately at the time of the presentation once the heart failure is diagnosed. The remaining two quarters are given after 12-hour intervals. So 12 hours later on, we give 100 microgram, and after another 12 hours, we give another 100 microgram. By this, we finish the 400 microgram. Again, 200 microgram is given immediately. For example, let's say the patient come after at 8 a.m. So at 8 a.m., you give 200 microgram. 100 microgram is given at 8 p.m. And another 100 microgram is given at 8 a.m. next day. So you finish the total digitalizing dose within 24 hours by dividing it into 3 hours, immediately 50%, and later on 25% of the total digitalizing dose. The maintenance dose is the last total digitalizing dose divided by 2 and given also after 12 hours. So for our example, the last total digitalizing dose was 100 microgram. So the maintenance daily dose for this patient is 100 microgram. This is should be given daily. Again, the maintenance dose is the last digitalizing dose. So it is 100 microgram, should be given daily, but divided into 2 parts. 50 microgram in the morning, 50 microgram in the night, and continue as long as you need digoxin to be used for your patient. So you see, the maintenance dose for your patient is 10 microgram per kg, for our example. You see, 10 is 1/4 of 40, which is the last digitalizing dose, equal to the last digitalizing dose. Of course, digoxin is somewhat causing arrhythmias. And once you notice that your patient got arrhythmias by ECG, which is mandatory to be done when you give digoxin to your patients, you have to stop it, except for prolongation of the PR interval. It's accepted and not necessary to change or withhold digoxin dose. But just delay in the administration of the next dose or reduction, but not withholding digoxin. Other types of arrhythmias, like prolongation of the QT interval, heart blocks, etc., needs stoppage of the digoxin. Mm-hmm. One important note that if you are giving digoxin orally, not parenterally, the digoxin absorption from the GIT is not 100%. Rather, it is by about 75%. So you have to calculate the total digitalizing dose and adding to it 25%. The same for the maintenance dose, because the absorption is not 100%. For example, in our example, we calculated it as 400 microgram. If we are going to give it orally, because the patient is stable and can take oral medications, in this case, the total digitalizing dose will be 500 micrograms rather than 400, because you are giving it orally. If you are giving intravenously, in this case, 400 only is given. Now, we got the drugs which acted on the preload diuretics, or drugs which acted on the myocardium. Now we get drugs which act on the afterload. So either decrease the preload or decrease the afterload or improve the myocardium. For the afterload, if we decrease it, the afterload on the heart, you will release, will relax the heart and give it better contractility and better stroke volume, even without increasing the myocardial consumption of the oxygen. And the drugs which decreases the afterload are also money. For example, we got the arteriolar vasodilators, direct arteriolar vasodilators like hydralazine, which primarily act on the arterioles. We got the drugs which are called venodilators, which have some effect on the arterioles also. Nitroglycerin, azidor bindimethate, acted primarily by dilating systemic veins and redistributing the blood from the pulmonary to the systemic circuit. They have some effect on the arterioles. And mixed vasodilators, dilating both venules and arterioles, like angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitors, like captopril, enalapril, sodium nitroprusside, and prazosin. These agents act on both arterial and venous beds, like these ones, but more powerful on the arterial. These are pure arterial. These are arterial, less extent venous, and these are venous, less extent arterial. You remember in the compensatory mechanisms of angiotensin II, we said that it is a vasoconstrictor. So if we block its effect by angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, you will get some sort of vasodilatation and decreasing the afterload. These are the vasodilators of different types. The main two for you are enalapril and captopril. These two should be remembered. The others are